So hi, I'm Verika, as ma'am also introduced me, and I'm also the founder of an organization called Mind Tribe, wherein we train students and professionals in the field of forensic psychology through online courses and workshops. Okay, so today we'll talk about eyewitness testimony. I hope like most of us here are, or I think most of us here are fans of crime dramas and TV shows. Which, you know, portray crime investigations. But however, you know, we are used to seeing that, you know, that popular media and crime dramas and shows to show us that, you know, our favorite detectives cracking the case and arresting the criminal very easily. But however, in real life, cases are rarely this straightforward. And there's often considerable uncertainty as to whether the person accused of the crime actually did it or not. And if you are a fan of crime dramas, you would also, you know, think that forensics and crime labs hold the key to solving crimes. But again, there, as I said, there's a high degree of uncertainty when it comes to solving a crime. So sometimes it is the verbal evidence from witnesses and victims that we have to rely upon the most to solve an investigation. So today we'll try to understand how can psychology be used to obtain, you know, accurate or more reliable evidence from eyewitnesses so that we can prevent wrongful convictions from taking place. So what do we mean by eyewitness testimony? So basically, eyewitness testimony is the account of a bystander or a victim that they give in the court proceedings or in the courtroom, describing what they observed that occurred during the specific, you know, incident or event in under investigation. Ideally, this recollection of events is supposed to be quite detailed. However, this is not always the case. And, you know, we have to also think about how accurate and reliable an eyewitness testimony could be, because it can only be as accurate and reliable as a human mind or human memory would let it be, right? So for us to actually understand eyewitness testimonies, we would have to have a greater understanding of how human mind works and how our memory works. So let us have a look at that as well. But before that, one of the key features that, or one of the key evidence that an eyewitness can probably provide, which would aid in the criminal investigation, is identity of the perpetrator. So often eyewitnesses are asked to, you know, identify the perpetrator and, you know, tell us who it was whom they saw commit the crime. But it has also been noticed that often there are a lot of mistaken identifications done by eyewitnesses. In fact, over 75% of wrongful convictions are due to mistaken identity done by eyewitnesses. So, you know, psychological research in the field have suggested that even making, you know, minor changes to the way police questions the eyewitnesses and obtains the evidence from them can have a drastic impact on what they remember and on their memory and on their decision making. So for instance, you know, if I, you know, ask you a question in a manner, it would elicitate a different response if I ask the same question, but frame it in a different manner, right? So similarly, it goes when it, you know, police questions the eyewitnesses. Now, even before, you know, you are asked to identify the perpetrator, the police has to carry out their investigation for about 4 to 6 weeks and draw a list of suspects, right? And then only you could probably identify. So for, you know, to make you understand better or give you a better perspective, I'll just, you know, play a very short 30-second video. It has no sound, but I would request you all to just observe as much as you can. And then in the chat box, you can just, you know, write a bit on what you see in the video, okay? So just write whatever you see in the video. And let me know if you can see it playing. Okay. So can I please request all of you to, or like few of you to at least respond on the chat box as to what you saw in the video? Like, what did you just see? Whatever is your understanding of what you just saw. Okay, so I've got two responses. So one says, Pavitra says that he intended to steal some document. Dhruv says a man taking a laptop. Okay, can anyone else also give me a little bit more detailed account of what you just saw? Okay, a man entered a room and took a laptop. A Caucasian man about 20, 30 years old taking a laptop from a room. A man taking a laptop while taking it observed he was watching. He also watched if anyone was observing him or not. Yeah, so making sure he's not seen by anyone. Yes, so these are all great observations. But now, do you think, so this was a video of a staged crime, okay? So after watching this video, do you think that, you know, if you were now to be interviewed by the police and asked as to what you saw, would you be a good eyewitness? Or would you be able to remember everything that you saw about the crime? Or even can you remember what the person was wearing? And can you remember what the person took? Everybody remembers that, I guess. Can you remember how many computers were there in the office? Or did he have to unlock or the door, or was it unlocked already? But one of the most important questions, like I said, is the identity of the perpetrator, right? Now, can we actually trust the witness's memory of the perpetrator's face? Because we would have to then understand how memory works to actually able to answer how accurate or reliable a witness's, you know, face recognition could be. So let us see. So like I said, you have to identify the perpetrator as a witness. And firstly, the police has to carry out their investigation and find out, you know, the list of suspects. And which probably at the least would take 4 to 6 weeks. Now I'm gonna just, you know, show you a photo lineup. And all you have to do is remember who the perpetrator is and remember their letter. So each photo would have an alphabet adjacent to it. So just remember the alphabet that you think is, like, you know, the perpetrator. And just, you know, put it on the chat box. And then, okay, so are you all ready? So just, okay. So just tell me who the perpetrator is and type the alphabet next to their picture. Okay. Can I get few responses? Yeah, okay. Okay, so I can see like many of you have replied and you all are giving me different answers. Someone says B, G, C, D, E, F, C. So there are various responses, right? Now, why do you think, and you know, like most witnesses, you also probably did not find it easy to work out what the perpetrator looked like, even though you just saw the video. So imagine how much impact would it have on the memory of an eyewitness who sees the video or like sees the photos after a few weeks of the incident. And let's see how you did. Like if you did pick out an alphabet, I'm afraid that, you know, you picked out an innocent person and you made a misidentification. So why do you think that you picked out an innocent person? So there are several reasons, psychological, you know, psychological research gives us several reasons why we why there are so many misidentifications. Firstly, the memory of, our memory of unfamiliar faces is very inaccurate. And we do not really remember, unfamiliar faces that often. And the person that you saw commit the crime just now was unfamiliar to you. You have never seen that person before. So it is very difficult for you to later then identify them and recognize them. Okay. Secondly, you saw all the faces in the photo lineup or in the identity parade at the same time. So what happens is that when we see all the faces in the identity parade at the same time, and if they are presented simultaneously, we try to find the best match, okay? So what we tend to do is that, okay, so this person's eyes don't match, or this person's ears is the different, or okay, this nose matches, okay, so he probably is a perpetrator. So we find the best match. So we do not try to pick out the perpetrator, but we in fact try to pick out someone who resembles the perpetrator the most, okay? And thirdly, it is quite possible that you picked out someone from the photo lineup because I asked you to. Because I asked a very leading question. I asked you, tell me who it is and remember the alphabet. Okay, so I did not tell you, and this basically this question suggested to you that the person would be there in the photo lineup. You know, the perpetrator would be there. So if we would make, minor changes to the way I questioned or the police questions eyewitnesses, then it would have a drastic impact on what you remember. For example, if I would have, framed the question such as, the person you saw commit the crime may or may not be present in the photo lineup. And if you don't think they are present, you should say so. If I would have questioned you in this manner, then it would not only remove the suggestibility that the person is definitely present in the photo lineup, it would also remove the suggestion that, witnesses have to choose someone, right? So this is also how psychological research can aid in better investigations. And if police is trained and investigating officers are trained well in the right way of questioning, it would elicit more accurate and reliable information from eyewitnesses. Now, there are a spectrum of theories and spectrum of psychological applications that we use in, understanding and aiding better investigations. And one of them is memory and theories relating to memory. And it's very important for us to understand human memory in order to understand how psychological principles are applied in understanding and eliciting accurate evidence from eyewitnesses. Now, we often think that we might be able to, recognize, someone and remember their name, but not remember any other information about them. But let me tell you this, that this is impossible. Because if you remember if you recognize someone and remember their name, you would most definitely remember something or the other about the person, okay? So even psychological research on facial recognition has found that if you remember someone's name, you will also remember other information about them. It could be a minor detail such as where you know them from, okay? But you would remember something else about them. Also, we all know that remembering one piece of information can trigger a memory of a different piece of information, right? For instance, a certain smell might lead us to remember a childhood experience where our grandmother or our mother was cooking something for us. So that experience itself would be remembered and come to us. Or let's say if you recall some information about something, we also tend to remember certain other information which is associated with that particular information. Because why does that happen? Because our memories do not exist in isolation. they are all interlinked and intertwined together, and there's a lot of association, you know, between each memories. Now, another thing is that our human memory is very fallible. Like we do not remember details and the order in which things happen as accurately as we think we do. We actually do not. Okay, we do tend to forget both the details and the order in which things happen. In fact, you know, we are particularly bad at remembering the order in which things happen, because our minds extract meaning from the world around us and make links between things based on that meaning. Okay, and memories are constructed. Now, so when we, you know, we do not remember the order because we are actually, we experience something, then we perceive it, we understand it, and we draw meaning through it. And that meaning is what we remember, actually. And that's why we often fail to remember the order. And this can be very useful when it comes to, you know, interpreting what we see and guessing what will happen next. But it also means that order is not necessarily preserved, okay? And research has also found that our memories can be very suggestible. And we are able to form memories of things that didn't even happen if it is suggested by someone else. Especially if someone of authority tells you something, then you would, you know, even if you do not have a memory of that experience, you will form a memory of that experience because somebody has told you that with a lot of confidence, and because a memory is very prone to suggestions. So, and memory is basically like a story, okay? And that is not written down, but told from person to person. And it constantly changes each time it is told. For example, if you know you would have to, you had a fight with someone, let's say, and you were narrating it to a friend of yours, you would say it in a different manner. And when you narrate the same experience using your memory to someone else, now another friend you're narrating it, there would be differences in the two stories. Maybe something is added, something is forgotten, or the order in which you're telling the things are different and things like that. Because it is, our memory is not like a tape recorder or like a computer, but it is more like a story, okay? If I had to, you know, give you an analogy, although it is very difficult to capture all the intricacies and complexities of human memory so easily into one analogy, I could probably say that our memories do change over time and can be different each time we remember them, and certainly can change dramatically when shared with another person. So now you see, when we are questioned about our memory, it can also change. So therefore, when eyewitnesses are questioned about what they see during a crime or during an incident, their memory would also change in the way they are questioned, depending on the way they are questioned. And there are several other factors as well. Now, let us see what eyewitness psychology deals with. Okay, so eyewitness psychology basically deals with questions such as what is seen, what is remembered, then, you know, how can the police best obtain reliable evidence through questioning, and also how are suspects identified. And to answer all of these questions, eyewitness psychology uses a spectrum of psychological theory. Like I just explained, theories of memory, theories of perception, theories of attention, and things like that. All of it is very much used to understand eyewitness psychology. Now, psychological research and law. So psychology and law do go hand in hand, and psychologists and lawyers do have, you know, a lot of things in, you know, their subject matter may overlap, but the aims of psychologists and lawyers are very different, and their approaches vary. Now, psychologists are concerned with obtaining, you know, reliable information about how human mind works and how psychology of, you know, different information regarding the subject of psychology by conducting rigorous research. Whereas, on the other hand, lawyers use more common sense psychology and they rely more on the accumulated experience and legal precedents. Whereas psychology is categorized by empirical methods and scientific analysis. However, law uses, you know, its internal systems to scrutinize the evolved legal processes. Now, it has also been seen that, you know, law is quite skeptical of, you know, disciplines such as psychology to be utilized in the field of legal cases. However, in the recent times, there is increasingly, you know, that psychology is being used in legal arena and psychologists work in collaboration with members of the legal profession. For example, in specialist conferences, also provide a forum for psychologists and members of the legal profession to come together and communicate with one another and find ways to work together and make the entire criminal justice system better. In parallel, there has also been a growth in both the number, you know, of postgraduate courses in forensic psychology, and there are a number of emerging disciplines relating to law and psychology, such as criminal psychology or just psychology and law has been a subject when you do law degrees nowadays and things like that. Because, and you know, rightly so, because the field of psychology is so vast and it, you know, different disciplines of psychology would, you know, undertake different, you know, purview of the investigation. That's why, you know, there are several disciplines. So there is a difference between forensic psych and criminal psych and things like that, because there are different applications of psychology in under each of these subjects. Similarly, psychological research can elicitate changes in the law and legal processes. For example, earlier child testimony was not given that much importance because it was seen as, you know, children testimony are very unreliable and inaccurate. But through psychological research, it has been seen that if, you know, proper questioning methods are implemented, even children would elicitate, you know, as accurate information as adults. Similarly, changes in policies and laws in, you know, can elicitate psychological research. For example, the implementation of CCTV cameras also prompted psychological research in the field of facial recognition through CCTV and things like that. So it's a two-way street between law and psychology when it comes to psychological research. Now, one of the major things that psychology is basically concerned with is miscarriages of justice, okay? Because it is, you know, a very concerning area, because not only the wrong person is convicted, but the real perpetrator is also freely roaming and free to also commit more crimes. So there are several factors identified for miscarriages of justice, which also plays a very important role in, you know, criminal investigations. And through psychological research, these are the major 8 factors which have been identified to be the leading cause of wrongful convictions. So there's eyewitness misidentification being the lead, like being the cause in over 75% of wrongful conviction. Then forensic blood analysis, and you would be surprised to see that even police misconduct and forensic analysis are also at the top of the list of, you know, leading to wrongful convictions. Then comes defective or fraudulent signs, false confessions, false witness testimony, informants, DNA inclusions. So all of these factors are the major cause for wrongful convictions, or in other words, miscarriages of justice. Now, Yeah, so the data used, or like how we come up with these factors, was based on an analysis of 74 cases where the original person convicted of the crime was later exonerated. Okay. Now, later research conducted by also the Innocence Project. So Innocence Project is a US organization which is solely dedicated to, you know, for exonerating wrongfully convicted individuals based on DNA evidence. Now, Innocence Project also conducted a similar research project based on 225 exonerations and revealed a similar pattern of results, with eyewitness mis-ID remaining the leading cause for wrongful convictions. Now, featuring in over 75% of the cases. Sorry about that. And the analysis showed that even forensic science featured in 23% of wrongful convictions. It is common, like I said, even in the beginning of my talk, that, you know, crime dramas portray forensic science as to be completely accurate and reliable, but often the techniques they show owe more to science fiction than to science fact. In reality, the accuracy and reliability of forensic science also varies greatly according to a particular technique in question. In addition, a great deal of forensic science is reliant on the interpretation and judgments of a human expert, right? And wherever human beings are involved, mistakes are ought to be made, right? Now, for example, I'll give you a few examples to better make you understand, and you do not have to blindly just agree to what I say, because all that I am saying and talking about is after rigorous psychological research and based on a lot of studies. Okay, so a study was conducted on fingerprint analysis that found that most fingerprint experts would change their decision about whether a latent print was a positive match based on whether other information about the crime suggested the person was guilty or not. This suggests that even forensic evidence such as fingerprint analysis can be prone to human error, right? Now, for example, in 2004, following a fingerprint analysis conducted by several of their experts, the FBI arrested Brandon Mayfield, a US citizen who had recently converted into Islam, in connections to bombings done outside of Madrid, wherein 191 people were killed. Now, 2 weeks later, Brandon Mayfield was released. Why so? Because the Spanish police made a positive match between the same fingerprints and another suspect, a match that later even FBI confirmed as being correct. So now, why do you think Brandon Mayfield was arrested in the first instance? Because there was also human bias involved. So whenever there's an investigation that takes place, right, there are several investigating officers and police and everybody involved. And that's why it's also said that, you know, when evidence is given in forensic laboratories and to forensic experts to, you know, to actually test and evaluate and, you know, assess, they are not supposed to know other information about the crime, which would basically make them more biased towards, changing their report in some way or the other. And they have to strictly follow a very scientific process. But since due to media and other factors, and if police investigators are actually sharing details about the case more than required with the forensic experts, then they might also become biased, because after all, we all are human beings. And this probably might be a reason why Brandon Mayfield was arrested in the first case, because he was a US citizen and he recently changed or converted into Islam. And he was present in the vicinity where the bombings took place, and that made him a prime suspect. So similarly, you know, there were several other cases. For example, the DNA bungle So DNA analysis, again, as we know, is a very robust technique and based on very sound scientific principles. But even it can fall foul of human error. How? For instance, in Germany, the German police for 16 years, okay, chased an elusive female serial killer known as the Phantom of Hellbrunn. As the same female DNA was found in 40 crime scenes, including 6 murders. Okay, it was eventually discovered that the cotton swabs used to collect the samples for DNA had been contaminated by a woman working in the factory where these cotton swabs were manufactured. So, and in fact, these crimes were not linked at all. And if you, so you see how even there we can, how, you know, their science faltered in a way, like, because human beings were again involved. Now, if you want to know more about this DNA bungle, you can know about it in the BBC News. So on their website, there's a lot of information regarding this particular case. And it is very interesting to read about it because for 16 years, they were after a serial killer who in fact did not even exist. Oh, like I said, the Innocence Project, if you know, you see how much miscarriages of justice or wrongful convictions are prevalent. You can also see through the Innocence Project, which is an entire organization just for exonerations. And one of the, okay, so there are several factors which affect eyewitness testimonies, okay? And these are broadly divided into 3 factors, majorly 2, depending on whether these variables or factors are under the control of the criminal justice system or not, okay? So there are majorly system variables or estimator variables. Now, system variables are those variables that are under the control of the criminal justice system. For example, the way the police questions the eyewitnesses or the process of the identity parade, or the photo lineup. So these are all under the control of the criminal justice system. And research in this field can help us, you know, come up with more reliable processes which could be made a common practice all across the board. Because if we know some process works and elicitate more accurate and reliable information, then why not adopt that all around, right? So for example, like I gave you in the beginning, that how minor changes or minor tweaks to the way we question eyewitnesses can have a drastic impact on what they say or what evidence they come up with. Similarly, if you know all police investigators are trained in that, and then they would probably come up with more accurate information. So these are called system variables. But however, we have seen, and Innocence Project has also shown us, that different kinds of crimes and different circumstances can lead to miscarriages of justice. And it is not that only one kind of crime would lead to miscarriages of justice, right? Now, so there are several factors affecting what eyewitnesses remember. And often these factors are at a disadvantage for us, like for eyewitnesses. And these, now there are certain factors called estimator variables, which cannot be controlled by the criminal justice system. For example, was the perpetrator wearing a disguise? What was the lighting like? What was the duration of the crime? How far was the crime taking place from the eyewitness? And things like that, because this cannot be controlled by the criminal justice system. But research in this field can also help us understand when to question the reliability and accuracy of the information given by the eyewitnesses. Okay, for instance, research tells us that there should be a minimum lighting of 15 lux. So 15 lux is a measurement of illumination. So minimum of 15 lux should be there for an eyewitness to actually make a proper identification. But not, research is no way saying that if the lighting is better than 15 lux or is at 15 lux, then it would most definitely, elicitate accurate information. Okay, just hold on. I'm sorry about this again. Yeah. But it would help the judge and the lawyers question it in the court that whether the information given by eyewitnesses are accurate or reliable, right? Similarly, the distance. So research tells us that the distance between the perpetrator and the eyewitness should be maximum of 15 meters. But again, it is not saying in any way that if it is less than 15 meters, then the information given by eyewitnesses would be 100% accurate always. But it gives us a reference point and a baseline to question the reliability and accuracy. Another thing that would also determine how eyewitnesses probably, would elicit more accurate or reliable information is the law, because law and different systems exist and vary from country to country. So there are two types of systems majorly. One is accusatorial and one is inquisitorial system. Now, accusatorial system is wherein the court of law is not directly involved in the investigation. So where two parties present their case, and then the judge or the court is limited to, coming up with the decision as to who is the right and who is not, and who is guilty and who is not. However, in inquisitorial system, it is more on the lines wherein the court is involved in the entire matter of investigation. The court actually conducts the investigation and, talks to all the people involved in the dispute and gathers all the information and then comes to a decision regarding who is right and who is not. But we primarily focus on accusatorial system here because it focuses more on, gives more emphasis on eyewitness testimonies and has more faults there as well. Anyway, so I'm running out of my time, so I'm going to quickly wrap up this by just telling you a few basic points about how there are several other estimates that eyewitnesses have to, take into consideration, such as the distance, the time, the date, or when, it happened. And also the age and the height and the weight of the perpetrator. But unfortunately, all of our estimations on all of these factors are quite inaccurate. Okay, we tend to estimate the period of time that crime lasted for if the event is more complex and complicated, then we tend to give it a longer duration of time. Whereas if the event is very simple, we tend to underestimate the duration of time. Similarly, when it comes to estimations of date, we are very poor at it, and it is inversely proportional to the retention interval as well. And we often do forward telescoping. That is, we give a date which is nearer to us rather than what actually took place. Okay. And we also often underestimate above average characteristics and overestimate under average characteristics when it comes to height and weight. And we often anchor ourselves, our own height and weight as an estimate to draw the estimate and weight of the perpetrator of any other person. And similarly, our age, sex, and personality might have an influence on what the witnesses remember. I am sorry I have to rush into this because I have exceeded my time. And so I, and there's something called co-witnessing effect, which is very important to consider when there are one or more witnesses to a crime. Then it is very much important that we do not let two witnesses talk to one another before the entire investigation. Because since I already mentioned, we form memories and our memory is quite suggestible. So there might be a convergence of testimony, but that does not mean accuracy. Okay? To summarize my entire talk so far is that confidence does not necessarily mean accuracy, because that could also lead to wrongful convictions. Just because an eyewitness is confident does not mean he's being accurate. Actions may be remembered better than details. Variables such as how far the witness was from the crime, what elimination was, and how long was the event for, and the perpetrators can all have an effect on the accuracy of the witness testimony. And people are generally not good at judging either the time or distance. And we often overestimate the duration of events that are complex. We tend to also be poor at dating events. Forward telescoping means that we assign a date that is too recent. And we also are not accurate when it comes to height and weight estimations. And we have a tendency to underestimate above average characteristics and overestimate below average characteristics. And the gender of witnesses may have an impact upon the evidence provided, but its influence is by no means clear cut. And age can have an impact as well, and co-witnessing, as I said. So if you want to get in touch with me, you can mail me at the given address, or you can also visit MindTribe's website and get in touch through there. And thank you for being a wonderful audience and bearing with me for so long.